Okay, everyone's here? Hello, everyone.
Hello.
I'm going to give a very unbiased view on React Native. So let's go over what we're going to talk about today. So for those watching at home, this is a tech talk at Pivotal Labs. So in Pivotal Labs Singapore, many of us have already tried React Native. And so everyone has their own opinions about this. So feel free to chime in whenever you want to agree with something or when you don't think that's the best way to do something. Not at home, but yeah. Maybe like YouTube comments.
Right.
Okay.
That's just the kingdom of really well-structured thought.
Exactly. Okay, so are we going over the motivation for React Native? Why do we need yet another JavaScript framework to do something? Just a quick look under the hood. What makes it special? What makes it different? Some of the top features which I've come to love and where I feel React Native lacks, and I would love to see some more development in those things. So, native apps. There have been over 200 billion app downloads when you put together both the stores, just Apple and Android. For whatever reason, which I'm not going to go into today, whether native is the way to go or not, people like native apps and they have their own use cases. Whenever clients come to us, they want us to build, there are a lot of clients who want us to build native iOS or Android apps. And most of the time it's like they want both. Right, so they need cross-platform native apps, and they do matter. What makes native apps different from, say, websites is that they are fast and responsive, they handle complex gestures, and you have a consistent user story. Basically, the feel of the app is consistent across each platform, and which is not reproduced by websites. But the main problem is when you want to target two different platforms, it turns out that building these apps is really hard. So when you're building cross-platform apps, you have different tech stacks for each platform. So Android has Java, iOS has Swift or Objective-C, everyone knows this. There's no code sharing unless, I don't know, you're using C binaries or something, I don't know. And the other thing which is one of the main problems with using just native apps is that there's a slow iteration speed. So as the apps become big, you need to wait a while for compile times and testing on physical devices. It becomes harder. And there's this delay from changing a file to seeing it on your own device. Who has already solved this? Web technologies, right? So for each of these, like, differing tech stacks, web technologies use HTML, CSS, JavaScript across all browsers. So you have the same code being used, and you also have very limited build time. In most cases, you just change a file, hit F5, and you see the result. Again, there are problems with website as well, but it's got this part right. And so it begs the question, why don't we just use mobile websites or wrappers? So what's the motivation for using native over creating a native wrapper around the web app? Again, it goes back to the same thing about look and feel, the consistency across platforms. So these are just three small examples of the same basic navigation in the two platforms, iOS on the left, Android on the left and iOS on the right. You'll see that there's a big difference, and there's a clear visual difference between the two. And the other one, which is more subtle, is the interaction. So if you notice this one, it's basically very similar stuff, but the way they behave is different. If you put the Android version on an iOS device, the users can tell, even if they're not able to point and say, okay, this is what's different about this app, but there'll be something wrong about it. And this is the main challenge that mobile web faces. So native still has better performance. Websites don't have complex gestures, so you have basic touch and drag gestures. Yes.
Can you go back one more?
Sure.
What am I looking at here? Is this a web wrapped app
Oh no, this is the same list view.
Yeah.
Interaction. It's actually implemented in React Native, but
okay,
this is inherently it's inherently using the native version of the list view.
This is an example of React Native in both platforms.
It is, but what I'm trying to focus here is if you look at the drag gesture, you'll see that the interaction is different. One, the whole whole list moves down, and then there's a different kind of spinner, and in Android it's something else.
Right.
You see the list doesn't move. So this is very small, subtle change between the two, and it's really hard to customize your web app to behave differently in this these kind of small ways across different platforms.
We want it to look like
exactly. This is what we want.
Agreed.
This is what we want to achieve, which is hard to do with just wrappers, right? So other reasons is that you can't use native components. So Android does a good, great job with its calendar widget. So you can choose a date and all that stuff. And it's familiar to people. So when you're picking a time on Android, it shows up a clock. And you can select drag and select the time, which is a familiar interaction for people who use Android. And if you put that on iOS, it will not work. So if you want to use native components on websites, you need to make like JavaScript mockups of these and try to achieve this, which is not really great. It's not a good experience. So what React Native is trying to do is get the great developer experience of developing web apps and apply it with native components. So you can build amazing native apps with it. And that's React Native. It's, as the name suggests, it uses React as its JavaScript side, and it runs natively on your device. So let's quickly look under the hood. How does it work? This is just going to be an overview, so feel free to stop me and ask me more questions. I'll try my best to answer whatever based on what I know. Before we get started with the native aspects, let's talk about the JavaScript side, which is React. So this is common knowledge for both. This applies for both React Native and React, and how the code is structured. So in JavaScript code, React is divided into different components. So React is a library that uses components that have props passed into it, which is some form of data, and it internally contains state. And what React ensures is that there's a unidirectional data flow. So as you can see, data flows from top to bottom. So each component internally has a render method with which it can call, it can render its children, which can be other components as well. Whenever a component state or prop, so anything in blue changes for that particular component, it calls the render method again. And this render method will internally re-render itself and its children. So that's basically the logic behind React. Yeah.
Can the state change without props changing?
The state can technically change without props changing if the component is making external calls or something.
Okay.
Because state is controlled by the component itself. Props are something external that's passed into the component and it's immutable. Right? So that's the logic behind React. What this enables is, yeah, go ahead.
Are those components visual, like UI components or?
They are visual components. They're meant to be visual components, yes. So each component has a view attached to it,
and
a render method attached to it.
In the graph, are they like nested or?
They are nested. So it forms a tree. We'll look at that in a minute. Go ahead.
So you have container components.
Yes.
Not necessarily visual, but they have interior components, which are, so you wrap up a router.
Yeah.
So that's a component. So then you have the rest of the app inside that.
Yeah. So even if you look at the implementation of the router, it is also just another component which has more components in it.
Right.
There's a render. It's not visual.
Not every component has to emit HTML. That's what Jason said.
Okay. So every render method needs to emit a virtual DOM. So the virtual DOM generally translates into HTML. And even the router, it will have different divs which will be rendered. So there is. Even though there is nothing visually changing on the page, there is still a view component attached to it. So let's look at that. I'll dig deeper into rendering. So this is what a render method normally looks like. There's, okay, a bit hard to see, but let's hope you can. Render is the key thing about React is that render method is stateless. So it has no side effects. It only operates on data. It's a pure function of data. So here, this.props.label is the data that's passed into this component. Similarly, this.props.onclick is a function that's passed into this component as props. If you see this, it looks something like HTML tags, but it's called JSX. We'll look at that in a bit as well. But what it does is that, if you notice, there's nothing else that's changing in here. So whenever there's a prop change, whenever the label changes or the onclick property changes, it'll change what's the output of this render method. But nothing else can affect the render method, right? So that's what I mean by stateless rendering.
So I have a question.
Yeah.
This example can also use state. It doesn't, but I'm guessing
tell me.
It's just using properties right now, but state can also be.
So by stateless, I mean the method is stateless.
Right.
The component might not be stateless.
So really, it's the render method is a function of your state and your props.
Yes, that's what I mean by data.
Okay.
So if you go back to the previous slide, anything in blue is data. So either state or prop.
Is it worth saying that the render method is pure?
Yes.
So it doesn't have any side effects?
Yes. It's a pure function, yes. Go ahead, Stefan.
Yeah, the next slide on, in the render method there, so this doesn't explicitly state that this is a React Native code snippet, but the tags in there layer correspondence to UI widgets, native UI widgets.
Mm-hmm.
Would that be the way in which you compose the actual layout of your UI by substituting a mapping between the tags and the UI components?
So basically, the render method looks very similar in React and React Native. The only difference is that React deals with HTML stuff. So instead of having view and touchable highlight, you'll have H1, H2,
right.
P tags, those kind of things.
Yeah.
In React Native, it provides a different kind of token. So you have things like view and touchable highlights, which are components provided by React, which translate into native views in each of the platforms.
So, in the documentation, there's a list of tags that they already provide. Those
right.
are what you can use.
They tell you what the tags, the native
yes.
elements of the tags matter.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Not always, actually. They don't tell you what it always maps. Because some of these, like touchable highlight, could be a JavaScript implementation. It's just that this is a box. Any click in here will trigger some call on JavaScript. So it needn't be that this touchable highlight will turn into a button element or something in native. It somehow manages. So in native, there's some code that's rendered, which you don't need. It's abstracted out away from you. So you don't need to worry about it. Which, let's see. So the output of this render method is a virtual DOM, right? So the Java JSX in React, this is it's like syntactic sugar. So this is using divs. So this is actually for just React, not React Native. But it works the same way. When you pass it through a Babel transform, this is what it comes out on the other end. So it's react.createElement div, which contains children, image, and H3. So as you will see, each of these tags translate into a react.createElement. And what this createElement does is it creates a node in the virtual DOM. So just a quick overview of virtual DOM. It's just a tree structure which is created in memory to represent what the document is supposed to look like. So whenever a render method is called, it creates a new version of the virtual DOM, and then it makes a comparison against the previous version. And if there's any change to any of these individual nodes, then what it tries to find the minimum number of changes to make to the previous DOM to make it look like the new virtual DOM. So that's how it tries to optimize its performance. But essentially, you could think of it as every time there's a new virtual DOM, the actual DOM looks like the new virtual DOM. How it happens is again abstracted out from. Another thing to notice is each node that's created here has one parent and multiple children. So again, it's a proper tree structure. So if anything changes at one node, that particular node and its children are affected. Now let's look at React Native itself. So React Native takes all the React stuff that we talked about so far and puts it in a JavaScript engine, which is running on a single thread in your device. There's also a native thread, which is the UI thread, and that's used to interact with, like it captures all your events. For example, there's a touch. So if you click on something on your screen, it's actually captured by the native thread, which captures the event and passes it on to JavaScript. The bridge is some form of inter-process communication so that it can send whatever information it captures here into JavaScript asynchronously, so that the UI thread is not locked. So, and it appears to be pretty smooth. In JavaScript, you capture this event, you figure out what components are affected by this touch. You look at your virtual DOM and see which nodes are affected. You pass that particular touch processing into that component and see if anything changed in the render method itself.
So you could, question.
Yes.
When you say you, is that the developer's job to ensure this event is passed correctly, or is that React?
No, React Native does that for
subscribers.
Yes.
So, all we have to
worry
about
actually, you don't even need to subscribe.
Oh.
So as soon as you create one of these things like the touchable highlight that
right.
I showed you, it has a native component on running on the UI thread already. So it knows how to talk to its JavaScript process.
When you're writing a bridge, you might need to. We didn't try writing a bridge itself.
I'll show an example later. So,
sorry.
This is pretty interesting. Yeah.
Is that literally two different processes or two different threads?
Two different threads.
Okay.
Yeah. But it could be two different processes as well. I mean, when it's running in your device, I think it's two different threads. But you can extract it out to two different processes. It's basically, there needs to be some interface on both ends to know how to transfer the information with each other. So when you're doing debugging, especially, it's to completely two different processes. I'll get to that as well. So again, it creates a virtual DOM. It makes a diff of the virtual DOM, figures out what native components needs to be changed, and makes those individual native calls in back through the bridge into the native side. So in case you're using iOS, it triggers UIKit to make some changes. Android also has the Android UI, right? So it uses the native libraries of Android and iOS to make the changes, make the visual changes that you see on your device. So JavaScript, so an interesting thing that I found out while I was researching this is that in iOS, it uses the JavaScript code that's already part of your device. So it comes with Safari, right? So JavaScript code is what Safari uses to render your web pages. In Android, it also uses JavaScript code, and this is actually bundled with your app as a library. So this means that the minimum size of an Android project is somewhere between 3.5 MB to 5 MB, because this additional JavaScript library is packaged with your code each time.
Thanks, Android.
The thing is, each Android device has completely different, like some have Chrome, some have something else.
Yeah.
So you need to have a standard way of processing this, and they chose to stick with JavaScript code.
So that explains why I'm saying.
Exactly. So this is something I found yesterday. So the next thing is, let's talk a bit more about the bridge. We know that there are two different threads running, right? So it needs to be asynchronous. That makes sense. But it also we can't use a single object anywhere and then just keep mutating it, because if there are multiple calls happening, there could be race conditions. So it needs to be immutable. It's also a serialized interface. This is actually a really cool feature of the bridge, because one, if you're developing React Native plugins, it is possible for you to capture this serialized information, record and replay them for testing. So that's actually a pretty cool thing that you can do when you're building React Native plugins which talk across the bridge.
So
yes.
The bridge is an object that's immutable.
Bridge is just some form of communication. The adapters on both sides. It's just a it's just a representation here. And the adapters talk to each other using some kind of serialized data. Serialized data is something like, something, it looks very similar to JSON.
Okay.
Yeah. So it passes data, it tells you like which elements needs to be changed, create this button or make this thing disappear. Those kind of calls. So there's a serialized interface that's passed across.
So is Bridge actually a program that's sitting in between?
No. It is just, Bridge is just a way for me to represent there is some communication between the two threads.
Architectural construct.
Yeah.
So if you wanted to write your own custom tags, mm-hmm. you'd actually have to write a bridge on both ends.
Yeah.
Or something.
Unless your custom tag is, if a custom tag doesn't depend on pre-existing tags, mm-hmm. and you want to make something that's completely new, you need to create some kind of bridge. Another cool thing about the bridge is that the processing is batched. So it, if there are calls that are faster than 60 FPS, they batch the calls together. So if you click on, you're really fast at tapping and you keep clicking on the thing like more than 60 times a second, or obviously there's some automated way of doing this, all the calls that are going through between these two threads are batched. And it's, so what the bridge, information passing through the bridge looks like is essentially just an array of different serialized objects. Okay, so one example of asynchronous execution is that when you have a remote debugger, which we'll look at later, you can still interact with this thing while JavaScript is paused. So that's a, that's something that I found pretty cool about. Another thing I want to talk about before we start looking at some code is styling, which I'll show you some more in a bit. This is unique to React Native. It uses JavaScript to style everything. There's no CSS. So there's a custom implementation of Flexbox, which may confuse a few people because there's a Flexbox for HTML, CSS as well, but this is completely different, and the same tags don't apply. So if you'll notice, it's just a hash containing different objects. Something cool about this is you can have like if conditions and all that stuff in your styles, though I wouldn't recommend you do this. So this is more powerful than SAS. So that's just an overview of some things. It's like slightly under the hood of React Native. Any questions? If not, let's look at some code as well. So I'll start off by showing some of the things that I find really amazing about React Native. The first and foremost thing, which many people here would agree with me, is that setting up Webpack, Babel, and all that shit takes like half a day, even more. And sometimes it doesn't even work. It's hot reloading, for example, is a feature that is really buggy when it comes when you're working with React or any other web app for that matter. React Native is really cool. It comes inbuilt with its packager, it comes inbuilt with Babel, everything. So out of the box, it's ready to go. So these are the four commands you need to run to get your Hello World app running on your Android device. That's it. Like if NPM is fast, you can get it done in under 60 seconds. And that is something that is just amazing about React Native, and more frameworks need to do this. So let me just show you what running these commands looks like. Okay, so it's technically I've added a few more, like two extra folders in here, but imagine that source tree doesn't exist. Everything else you see here is what comes with running those four commands. You have an index.android.js and index.ios.js. There's a package as well. In the package, you will see let me make this a little bit bigger. You'll see that all this one depends on is React and React Native. Nothing fancy about it. Come on, okay.
Like the app manifest.
Yes, this is like the app manifest. This is the package file. Anyone who's worked with NPM modules before will find this extremely familiar. Along with this, you have your android.js, which is your root folder, like root file. Entry point for Android, and similarly you have the same thing in iOS. It's literally the same code. There's no difference between the two right now. So this is basically the structure which I was talking about. There's a class called React Native Counter, which extends the component, which is provided by React, and it has a simple render method in it, which creates another thing called counter.
Generated this when you made the app, or did you write this?
This class is generated. I just created this counter thing just so that to make it look a little bit better. But by default, it just says hello world, and these are the files you have to change, and this is the documentation you can look at.
So you wrote this React Native counter to illustrate a little bit more beyond what the default app generation script is.
Yes, right. Yes. So by default, everything except the source tree, source folder comes with React Native, and that's amazing. By default, everything starts working. And so let's look at this. So once you have initialized one of these projects, all you need to do is npm start. This one creates a packager. This is not using Webpack. It's React Native has its own packager, and it listens to port 8081. And if I go into iOS, I just have to refresh, it loads from 8081. It says, okay, there's a request here. It's trying to find an iOS, index.ios bundle. The platform is iOS and dev, it's in dev mode. It's finding dependencies. It's packaging everything, and that's it. That's all there is to it. And it's a simple app, which is like you click buttons and you just increase.
And those are native controls on there now?
Yes. Everything you see in here is native.
So that's interesting. So it actually bootstraps it by loading it from its own, was that a HTML or a web page resolver or something that loaded? Because it looked like it bootstrapped itself off the server. The way that you guys have been distributing copyright in the office. It bootstraps itself off the server?
I don't really get the question.
No. It's running in development mode. Right?
I'm running it in development. Yeah.
The version that it took, the version of the app that it deployed to the iOS simulator is looking for stuff on his file system in order to do hobby loading.
Yeah. Right. I'll talk about that in a bit as well. But the cool thing is this iPhone emulator is just running off the code that is defined in here. So this is the iOS package that comes inside React Native. And let me show you that.
When you ran npm start, one of the things it did was it built an iOS Xcode project.
Yeah. No, when you do the initialization itself, it creates it. So there's this Xcode project in here, which you just open in Xcode and hit run, and you get an emulator running your code. It's that simple.
In the Xcode, if you have an Xcode, what does it actually run? Does it start up? I'm trying to understand what actually happens.
So what it does is it packages, it creates an iOS app with all the things in the native side, installs it onto your emulator, and then that emulator talks to the packager to find what are the JS files available on your device, application.
Does it do an interpreted runtime translation of the JavaScript? Or does it do transpiling into code?
Nothing. So this goes back to the bridge that we talked about. So JavaScript is running as JavaScript in a JavaScript engine. So this thing is pure JavaScript.
Right.
And the output of the JavaScript is a virtual DOM and the list of changes that need to be made to the native app to make it look different. For example, when I click increment, it says go to this particular text box and change the value from 6 to 7. And that's the command that is passed across the bridge into the native side. So that's what's really cool about this and differentiates this React Native from something like PhoneGap. Where PhoneGap, the native side is just basically a glorified web browser. In this one, it's really JavaScript driving the native code. So that's what makes this stand.
So the reload, all that is doing is removing your old JavaScript and
essentially.
That's it. It's only the right hand side that's changing.
Yeah, I'll talk a bit more about that as well.
So
go ahead.
Would I be correct in saying if I go to my package.json, if there is some random JavaScript library or any NPM module that provides me, say, email validation functionality, I can just pull that in. That would actually be usable within my application as the JavaScript. just call it directly from the microphone.
Yes. Though there's a small thing to remember, many JavaScript libraries assume that you're running in the browser and they access browser functions. If you do that, it's going to fail because right now you only have a JavaScript engine, there's no DOM. And this is a problem we commonly face when you're working with NPM packages.
For example, I think the same applies if it's targeting nodes specifically in front of your process.
Yes, right? Yes. There's no multi-threading on this.
They have to be purely abstracted libraries.
Yes. So something like Lodash works perfectly.
Yeah.
But if you want something, say, that creates WebSockets
and
stuff,
it's a specific platform API. Then
yes,
I'm
yes, yes.
The
mm-hmm. So let me do the same thing for Android now. So all you need to do is you need to say ADB devices, make sure that an emulator is connected, and then I just do React Native run Android. And that's one command. It packages your JavaScript files. It packages whatever is there in the Android folder of your code, and then runs it in an emulator. Runs it in simulator.
React Native run iOS. You know.
Yeah.
You could. Yeah. So this will look familiar to anyone who's using Android. That's it. Same code. Yep. So now going back into. The next really amazing feature about React Native is cross-platform code, right? You are still using native components, but your JavaScript code is able to talk to both platforms. It's amazing that it can use the same file for both platforms, and also you can have overloading. So let me show you what I mean by that. So in code, right now, this one, which is my index dot, say I'm going to look at the iOS one, index.ios.js, it is calling the counter. Counter is inside my components, and if I look here, all it does is it has this thing where there's a text that renders this.state.count, and then there's a button that says on click increment. And all increment does is it increments the state. That's all it does. And the same code is running on both iOS and Android. So index counter.js is just one code. But on the other hand, button, which is a custom component I created, has two versions. There's a button.ios.js and button.android.js. So let's look at the iOS app running here. So button.ios.js, I go in here and say, it says, props are labeled from iOS. I'll change this from this to say, hello. I save this and yeah, what happened? It is on by default, but maybe let me show. Enable live reload, it's not on. So anyway, I'll just do the regular reload. Command R. Right?
No, I'm just live reloading.
So this is, in dev mode, you have this help window when you shake the actual device. In iOS emulators, you can simulators, you can just have a shot. So it's basically the same thing. Okay, so hot reload, by what hot reload is supposed to mean is that when you have a DOM and you're changing just one part of the DOM, just that part is switched out.
That component
is switched out.
When you have a component hierarchy, and
yeah,
you edit like a third level down,
yes,
it will swap out only that component.
I can show that. So look at this. So right now it is this 5. And it says hello pivotal. When I do a refresh, it loses its state, right? So now I'm in at 6, and then I say hello, and then I save this. Okay, this is still live reload mode. Okay, yeah, we need to enable hot reload. There we go. So I'm in 6, and then I go here and change in word. There. It changed the app, it changed the view without messing with the state. It's not doing a full view.
Styles and whatnot will also update.
Yes, same thing. So I go into my styles and I can say, hey.
So you get to a certain state in your app, and then you're like, you know, working with your designer and you want to tweak it to be a certain way.
I just save.
You don't spend time making your state back to how it was to see the changes.
And this is something you can't do with native apps.
Does this only work with styles? Like if I change the counter to say multiply to
it will work.
Anything actually.
The state and the props are not changing, but how the counter.
Just the views change. So in iOS, I go in here and say, on where's the text? Counter.js.
Yeah.
In increment, I will say instead of plus 1,
plus 2,
right? Now, when I click this, see? So it basically changes whatever logic, whatever JavaScript you change. And there are some weird edge case bugs that I've seen with this, but most of the time it works pretty well, and I'm really happy with it.
So, just to speak to cross-platforming, it supports both platforms. What about the third platform, the Windows Phone?
Nah.
Windows has a phone.
Microsoft just help us out with that. Like, just removed it as an option.
For hot reloading, does it work when you create new components?
Not always. Sometimes, the thing is, I have seen that sometimes the packager does not work. So when you have a new component, the watchman instance that's looking at file changes doesn't realize that there's a new component, and sometimes it doesn't figure it out. And you might need to restart the.
Well, if you restart it, the watch
will create a new file. So whether the watch will be able to pick up a new file.
So I think mostly it does sometimes.
In.
But sometimes there's five of ones.
Yes.
Right? So it should be.
It's basically the use case. It's meant to be like quick changes, like you make style changes or you change the text to make it. What would it look like on each of these devices? You can have 3-4 devices running and then you can try, right? And you can also use this on a physical device. So Android, if you're running it on your actual device, you can still link it up to this, and hot reloading will work even on your device when it's remotely connected.
Which means further command.
Yeah, but yes.
So, in the past, this might actually be a problem anymore because I have an actually worked with the emulators on faster computers. I worked with emulators from a few years ago. It's pretty slow, chaotic. The Android emulator, actually just the Android, all the emulators were really, really crazy hogs for memory.
Yeah.
How is this one? Is this one faster? Is it still a problem with the emulator being slow? Is it still better to work with the hardware than the emulator? Are you fine?
Not too much of a thing. It seems okay, but the thing is.
Is it okay because of technology has moved on, or is it because of React Native?
I don't think React Native in any way helps with emulator performance.
Yeah.
But in general, for Android dev, we found that working with an actual device is always better.
Yes, but it doesn't help with the.
So the emulator is better than hardware.
Although it doesn't help with the emulator performance, for each change you don't have to regenerate
it
APK and reload the whole thing, right?
Yeah.
So that way.
You don't need to keep hitting run.
Your dev cycle speeds
up. Exactly.
Yeah.
So. Basically, that's what this is. So, yeah, this is an app developed by Facebook. It's for their F8 conference. Even though they look really different, one left one is for iOS and the right one is for Android, they look really different. Most of the code is reused. If you will notice that the schedule, my F8, and all that stuff that's seen on the sidebar for Android version is at the bottom for the iOS version here. So it's just a style difference and which component it's using to render. And by doing this, most of this stuff, which is like the schedule and stuff, it's the same thing in the background here. And this means that there's a huge amount of code reuse between the two platforms. And pottery load. I don't want to demo this, but yeah. That's how you feel when you just change something and it actually changes on your phone as well. And you can have multiple devices connected to the same package. Next thing, this is also really cool. So let me show you on the simulator. I come on here. I say I want to look at my inspector, click on this, and it tells me the styling. This is basically like doing development on Chrome. I have performance analysis to see drop frames or what's going wrong and things like that. And yeah, there's like sys trays, there's all kinds of stuff you can.
Can you also figure out what state it is at right now, like what the problem state is?
You can use remote debugger for it. I'll show that as well. So in-app inspector, really awesome. Debugging, that's the next one I'm talking about. This is a familiar thing. You keep clicking next, 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 you figure out what's happening. Debugging feels like this. So it's a very good feeling to work with React Native. It has these extremely clear error messages. Even when you have stupid errors like null is not an object or undefined does not have this thing, it tells you exactly where it was called, which file, and it gives you these nice colored representations. Yellow means warning, red means error. So let me show you one example.
And a lot of times where it actually can suggest a solution, it also gives the...
Did you mean this? Yeah. Here's the thing. So my button expects to... So button.ios expects there to be two props passed into it. There's an onClick and a label. It says onClick needs to be a function and label needs to be a string. Now, if I go into my counter, let me show the app. If I go into my counter and say my label, instead of increment, I want to pass the value.
A number. Or a boolean.
Yeah, sure, why not? There you go. Let me just disable this thing. Hide inspector. Check this out. It says, warning, invalid prop type. It got boolean instead of string.
So you don't need to use prop types. You should talk about that.
Yeah, you don't need to use prop types, but if you're using like ESLint or any tool that recommends the right way to, the best way to write code, it always suggests that you create prop types for any data that's passed into your components. And that gives you like some level of type safety, but this is not the same as compile time. I know, yeah.
When you specify it has to be a string again, can you show that code?
Yeah, sure. So in the component, which is button, everything about the button is encapsulated here. You have specs, styles, and the button itself. So here, you have prop types, which say that it needs to be a function or a string. And you can say if it is required or not. So you, if it is required and you forget to pass it in, it will again give a warning.
What's a button spec.js?
OK, so I don't have specs on this project, but I just added it in there to show what a directory structure generally looks like. That's where you add your unit tests.
So assume for like, let's say, on click, can it have more than one prop type?
No.
So it's just only one?
Yeah. You can have a complex one which just says object. And object is just, it can be a hash or anything.
Yeah.
You can be as you can also say it's not required.
So it's either I'm very specific or...
No. You can have object of this format, like where you have these keys. You can have that.
Yeah. You can have. So there's some level of stuff. And with live reloading, as soon as you're editing, suddenly you see this yellow screen, you know, oh, I did something wrong. Similarly, there'll be a red screen if you do something crazy as well.
Yeah, but then again, all these things, right? It's the developer's choice to add the prop types. So that way, if you're careful, you add the prop types. But if you don't add prop types at all, then it will not even compare. It won't give you all these
So yes, Lynx prompts you if the prop types are screwed up, and like even React Native.
Yeah.
But does ESLint prompt you if you do not have prop types?
Yes, it does.
It does. If you use a prop...
Configure ESLint as a prompt. Right.
Yeah. Again, it's a choice.
Right.
It's a slippery slope because people will be like, oh, I don't want these stupid error messages, and you can disable it, but generally not a good thing to do. Next thing, live reloading. Remote debugging. So you click on this, it spins up a debug UI in Chrome. So now I can just look at my inspect, and if I look at my console, what's happening?
Your prop type exception.
It's possible it's the prop type exception that's causing the issue. It seems like it's kind of hung.
So
no.
Prop type exception is usually a warning if you still
make it. Ah, come on.
That's an Android.
Android, the problem with this emulator is that you can't shake it. So you don't have the options. And the newer device don't have the options button on the bottom. So that becomes a problem. But okay, essentially what it does is that in here, anything you have like console logs will appear here. And how it does this is pretty interesting. You can have breakpoints here as well. Right? How it achieves this is by making a slight modification to the same diagram we saw earlier. What happens here is it replaces the bridge with, instead of inter-process communication, it now uses WebSockets. And your JavaScript, everything that we initially talked about, the same thing now runs in V8 inside a Chrome tab. And there's communication using WebSocket. So native code still runs on your device and the JavaScript runs in Chrome. People have taken this to a crazy extent where people have installed this thing in Heroku. And your app can literally stream, every time you touch something, it makes a call to Heroku and asks Heroku, what should I change on my native app? So you can do that kind of stuff.
The problem with this though is now you can have a library that relies on your web browser, right, of V8-specific features.
Yeah.
You won't catch that error by debugging because it'll work here, but not on your native.
Yes, I think,
right.
Yeah, them could be
that's
kind of,
one.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, do they do anything to prevent that?
I'm not aware of that. I should
there
actually check.
Tests.
There are tests, but I'm sure they would have done something like that. I need to check. It's a good question.
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
What you test in the. At least what we use the debugger mostly was to see what are the props, what is the state, and, you know, the data is what we. Kind of focus on, yeah.
Rahul.
Yep.
Does this work with, so React, they have their own Chrome plugin, but React, React.js Chrome plugin.
Yes.
It allows you to see the state and the prompts.
Yep.
You get to inspect what's the current state.
Yeah.
So
I,
does it work with that Chrome plugin?
I have not tried it, but I'm assuming it might, but at the same time, I can't be sure. I need to check. Most often what the way we use this is we put like a debugger, like a breakpoint in the code itself and then just stop there and then look at the object and stuff. So I think we're running out of time, so let me move a bit faster. Next one, which we really love, is code push. This is not technically a feature of React Native itself. It's a library by Microsoft. What it does is it deploys your, okay, you need to configure for your application to have the code push libraries on Android and iOS. What it does is it keeps track of your JavaScript files. And every time you publish a new version of your JavaScript components, it will dynamically replace the JavaScript files running on your users' devices. So people could have already installed it and it'll live update. And that's really amazing. Some of the cool features about this is that there's auto rollback. So suppose the new version of JavaScript breaks something, it'll roll back to an older version. Unless we do something very crazy. then there is segmentation, A-B testing. You can also have different groups, like you want to have a dev group, you can have a staging group, and then you can have production, yeah.
Is this how you guys come to managing the live deploys of copyright?
Yes. Yeah, so this is really easy to work with, especially in our agile methodology where we use a staging server and we want our product owner to see the latest version of an app instead of sending them new versions of the APK.
Do you know whether that works with React Desktop as well?
I'm not sure. No, okay. I don't think it supports it right now. Right now, it's only for Cordova and React Native on iOS and Android. Yeah, okay.
You said this was a library, but I believe it's also half a library and half a service.
It's a service, yes.
Okay. Is it free to use?
It's free to use as of now.
For now.
But the big question we have is about the big question is about like security and all that, which is something we need to consider before we use this for a real client project. Mm-hmm. One shortcoming of this is that if you are making new code that uses native aspects, which so that means you're writing code that bridges the JavaScript native views, you can't push using code push because the native components don't get published. Only JavaScript files can be changed. Yeah.
So do you know of anyone writing an open code push service? Look at Basket.js self-host.
Which one?
Look at Basket.js.
There are some already.
So code push makes it super easy to release a new version as well. It's just this one command where you just determine your specify your app name and which platform you want to release to.
Awesome.
There are also extra options like I want to release it to 10% of the people over this time period and things like that.
Oh, that's
which is really cool.
Yeah.
So if you don't want to like load your servers and for some reason. The other thing. We were actually walking around finding people to talk to. It was so amazing. We had to spread the word. Yes. So another really good thing about React Native is that there's a lot of development happening. There's a strong community and there's also backing from Facebook. So I think it's worth investing our time learning, picking up this language because picking up this framework, since there would be growth in the future. So next I want to talk about some things I think React Native falls short on and some places that it might, some examples where it's not a good fit. So one such example is this Runkeeper app. So this is the iOS version of Runkeeper and this is the Android version. If you'll notice the views, there's extensive difference between the two views. Mm-hmm. And also, I'm sure that they're using a lot of native features, GPS, it needs to use maps and all that. So in this kind of scenario, what will end up happening is, if you use React Native, you'll have to fork each and every one of your files, a majority of your files. This just ends up becoming very hard to maintain. So in these kind of examples, when we have clients with very different views across platforms, it might not be a good fit.
But if you think about it in terms of the logical interaction that your component is performing, you could probably still share all of the business logic code, you're just wiring up to different views.
Yeah.
Okay.
But there's, go ahead.
For all you know, they probably wanted somewhat similar, but because they were different developers,
entirely possible. It's entirely possible. But where it becomes a problem is if you're using separate views for both platforms and you're using native components, there'll be a lot of bridging. And if React Native is only used for your logic. So that ends up becoming the next problem, bridging code. One of the cool things about React Native is there's native interop, so you can communicate with Android or iOS. So how doing that is also pretty fairly simple. This is an example where iOS is talking to React Native. All you need to do is call this RCT root view, and you say that I want to target this one, image browser app. This is a component, and these are the props I'm passing into it. So props are also defined here. And that basically just makes a call to this one. It gets its new props, and it can use the image here. So this is really basic. So this is just a very simple example. There are also more complex versions where JavaScript can talk back to native code as native code, and it can make view changes. But the problem is, if you're using React Native only for your logic and all your views are written in the native side, there'll be a lot of this kind of bridging code, and it becomes a kind of an overhead. some places where you can't get away from using bridging code is when you want to use custom native components. So this is, I think it's a stepper counter for Android. So if you want to use something like this, and this is your setup kind, setup app, setup flow for your app, you need to use custom native components. The other thing is you need specialized hardware features. So you want to talk to the headphone jack or something. And the last thing is multi-threading. So this is one of the, I would say it is a React Native. The JavaScript side can't create new threads. It needs to call the native side to create new threads. Yeah.
So when you're building a React Native view in iOS, for example, you have to extend from the base class, or is there a way of doing it by composition? So is there like a prototype for?
I'm not. I haven't actually created much bridging code, so I'm not very sure about that. So I don't want to give. I'm assuming there might be, but I don't want to say that unless.
Right. You said something on it. I see, nicely native components, custom, but I don't have to re-implement it. It's inherited only. Whereas if it's something I can post in, then I'm safe.
I need to double check and get back to you. Okay. Can I go over for another 2 more minutes and just finish it off? Okay, so last one, last couple slides. This is the problem which we already talked about. There are so many packages that assume that you are running it in a browser, running your code in a browser, or you're running it in a node environment somewhere. And you have all these weird errors that happen because the new version of a library assumes that you're running it in a browser and adds some extra functionality. This is something that we faced with Firebase, which Jason can talk more about as well. When Firebase went from 2.4 to 3.0, they included a lot more features such as cloud messaging, analytics, and all some other stuff which required a browser to be present. And that just basically broke support for React Native. And these kind of things happen because it's not yet mainstream, and when people make huge changes to well-established libraries, they don't consider React Native as one of the platforms that they need to support. So hopefully things will change, but yeah, this is something you need to be comfortable handling when you are getting into React Native right now. One way we have found to solve this is by using this site called JS Coach, which I can't highly, highly recommend this site because they have, it's updated daily and it's curated. So if something goes out of date and something is not supported anymore in React Native, it'll let you know. And another thing that's amazing is it tells you which of these libraries work on Android and iOS. So you can say like, okay, I'm only interested in Android, so I can choose only the libraries that support Android. Those kinds. So this is a really cool website.
So those that list are the popular libraries to use with React Native?
Yeah.
So, for some reason, the Pivotal also has so many React components which didn't show up here. So I don't know whether we could do something to make it show up here.
Not sure how. So
they're not React Native.
React also. This gives for
this
React.
This has for React as well. React, Webpack, browser, if I'm there. Okay. I'm going to move a bit faster right now. Unit testing is hard for React Native. The reason being, you're running your tests in a console. You don't have access to any of the native components. So how do you do this? You essentially replace your React Native with a mock React Native. And what mock React Native ends up being is just React. So you switch back from React Native to React, and you replace all your native components like views and list views with just divs. So it becomes like a tree with just divs in it. This becomes a problem because when you have components that contain logic, like for example this recycler view, back scroll view, you can define things like, okay, I want to only show the first 5 and then later slowly load the next few. This logic cannot be tested at the unit level. You need to write integration tests for this. So all you can do in a unit level is say that, hey, I expect list view to be present, and I expect list view to have the props, list view to contain props render row, which is equal to my render row, something like that. So the tests you can do is basically black box tests that say, is it present? Yes or no? Are these props being passed into it? Yes or no? That's all you can do. So it's kind of limited. You can obviously test logic better, but for view tests, this is something I found to be pretty limited. And when you go to integration testing, there are all these tools that people recommend: Appian, Espresso, Xcode, Roboteam. All these things are essentially tools for individual platform, Android or iOS. You can't write just one set of integration tests that will run across both platforms. And that is also something I hope will change in the near future. Like, you can write JavaScript integration tests and that'll just run on both devices. So with that, I'm ending my presentation. So I really enjoyed React Native. I found React Native to be very easy to install, to use, to debug, and to even deploy using CodePush. It's really powerful because, unlike other web wrappers, you have access to native code, you have multi-threading, and it's really fun to use. Sweetie? Come on. GIF fail. Yay. Yeah, this is two class. We did try to create a wrapper application for a Spree web store.
Yeah, because all the things you mentioned as advantages and disadvantages, I feel applies equally well to Cordova apps. Mm-hmm. So the main difference is that one, you get to use React, which is obviously cool. Two, they have a lot of pre-built components that already provide native UI. And that seems to be the two main advantages in this, just using Cordova. And Cordova has passed the adage of, if you build your website right, you can mostly just take it and shove it in there.
So that's where there's a difference in the way you build the application. So when you come into React Native, the amount of effort required will be much higher. But when compared to Cordova apps, because it's not running in a web view, its performance is better. And it feels more native-like. So that is the primary difference between the two. And since Cordova is also having plugins that can connect to Android and iOS, you could technically use that. But when you have to work with both your web app and native code simultaneously, it gets kind of messy. Here, JavaScript is always talking to native, and there's no HTML anymore. So it's much easier to work with than Cordova.
I'm just curious if you have verified a thing that it becomes messier, because the parts that sounds to me like it would make it messier are the same parts that you mentioned. For example, you mentioned that it gets messy when you have things that are vastly different between iOS and Android.
Yeah.
That are the parts that would be mostly messy with Cordova as well. So that problem still exists.
But I mean, when it's vastly different, I'm talking about like small changes like what we saw, we can have overloaded JavaScript files, right?
Yeah, you can have it on Cordova too. You just have one that runs on iOS and one that runs on Android.
Right? Okay.
Isn't it the case that if you're going to be wrapping a web view, your goal is to have something that is a little more investment, and in that case, Cordova is a good thing. Whereas if you're bringing an app in, then React Native should be a contender alongside you.
Oh yeah, I don't agree with that. It's more
completely different use cases.
Mm-hmm.
Though the same,
and
whatever, pros and
cons of IP. So I just think that there could be more reuse from doing the rapid events. Mm-hmm. Like, if you have a lot, if you know the app is going to be really well used, then you do need the performance. There's no question.
So there's another point here where the web viewing particular device is of a specific web version, and then you have all kinds of browser rubbish you've got to deal with it.
Yeah.
Instantly gone with React Native.
That's a very good point.
Then you don't know until you've deployed to 1,000 devices, and then a significant portion of your user base goes, and you're up free for your.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like other devices that doesn't support 3D versus the ones that does, and then you have to do special jittery apps.
So you don't do any of that kind of worrying, and all of a sudden you're in a much bigger, much faster than you would be with the web. It's arguable in X number of years, those problems are gone. But the future doesn't exist.
No.
happen all the time. So,
especially when I use Android.
So, if I want to target both the iPhone and iPad, do I have to change stuff?
Interesting question. I don't know. Actually, that's a really
good iPhone and iPad.
Right, assume that because the iPad has a more real estate, right? Okay. There's like a mask, like a. When I open it like that, I can see like the sidebar, for example.
So, there are two ways to do this separation of .iOS. You saw the file differences, right? We had a .iOS.js. .android.js.
Right.
Similarly, there is another way to achieve the same. When in the file, you can actually inspect what device it is and then make that difference. That's then the So maybe using that, you can actually have a different version for the
iPad. Right. Is that particular for the device or like form factors in a more generic sense?
Yeah, because Android has like awesome form factors.
Yeah, I don't know if you go for iPad or.
Imagine if you're using like Flexbox, it's going to take care of some of.
No, so the thing is, when we ran it on an iPad, it just looks like when you run an iPhone app on an iPad, it just looks this like really stretched out, zoomed in. It's not. It by natively, I don't think it supports iPad.
There's the devices that you change the volume info.
This one?
Yeah.
In the middle of the screen.
Which one? This guy?
No.
Oh, yeah. That's a good idea.
Universal.
So it would be charging in the middle of the screen.
But what this is a certain component that's exclusive on the iPad, right? The one
that's
it's
right.
Like,
yeah.
It's an easier component that's exclusive to the iPad because of its large risk. So it could be.
Let's see.
I don't know, it seems like you call it at runtime and you try to load it on iPhone. It's crashed. You know, you can code.
So I'm.
You probably have to be able to different. React Native component.
Yeah.
So
in
your
iOS file,
you will have a
different
condition.
Yeah, that
condition
is possible. You can.
Right. Or you
can figure it out. Yeah, that's good. It's
reasonably good.
Like
wrap up.
Hey, it looks pretty okay. Maybe, yeah. It might be okay to work.
At least keep the same phone.
How? Yeah, I think it does. Cool.
Thank you.
Stefan, are you a believer?
Yes, Stefan.
Repent, Stefan.